Ooh, this woman is taking the CELPIP exam, and she's doing the listening part of the exam. Now, a lot of people really struggle in the listening part of the test. So, in this lesson, we're going to do some practice questions, and I'm going to teach you some really helpful things. Okay, so if you want more practice like this, I would be so happy if you subscribe to my channel right down there. Okay, so before we look at any practice questions, I just want to teach you this term. Do you know what this term means? Have you ever heard it before? School of thought. If you're thinking about a school, forget about the school because this term has nothing to do with a school, okay? It just means a set of core beliefs or opinions about something. Okay, that's what school of thought means. Let's take a look at an example. Okay, take a look at these two universities. Okay, that university teaches Western medicine. This university teaches natural medicine. Okay, so all the professors at that university would say that if you get cancer, the best way to treat cancer is with chemotherapy or radiation therapy. That's where they pump your body full of chemicals to try to kill the cancer cells. Okay, now all the professors at this university would say the best way to treat cancer is through natural remedies, like maybe a special diet or special herbs and supplements. Okay, they would say chemotherapy is bad. That hurts your body. That makes your body, it gives your body a harder time to heal from the cancer. So don't listen to those guys. They don't know what they're talking about. And those people there, they say, no way. You can't cure cancer through your diet. You have to use chemotherapy, otherwise you're going to die. Okay, so these two are very different schools of thought. Okay, now we're not talking about the building, we're not talking about the school, we're talking about the set of ideas that are different. Okay, those ideas are called a school of thought. Okay, take a look at this woman. That woman says that humans are not meant to drink animal milk. Humans, we're not meant to drink animal milk, okay? It'll make us sick. It's not good for us, okay? Human milk was meant for human babies. Cow milk was meant for cow babies. Okay, humans shouldn't be drinking cow milk, okay? That's not how our bodies were made. Okay, a lot of people believe that. So that's a school of thought. Okay, lots of people, they believe that people shouldn't consume animal products. Okay, this is just one idea, but there are other ideas going to be attached to this idea, right? Do you think she's going to eat meat? Probably not. I mean, it didn't say, she just talked about milk, but we can probably assume that she's not going to eat any animal products. No meat, no cheese, no eggs, okay? So that's a school of thought. Now take a look at this guy. This guy says that humans are not meant to eat meat, okay? Humans weren't made to eat meat. Our digestive systems are not made to digest meat. Okay, we should be eating plants, fruits, vegetables. Okay, now take a look at this guy. This guy says humans are meant to eat meat because they have canine teeth. Canine teeth. The word canine means dog, okay? Like this dog here. See this tooth here? This tooth is called a canine tooth. And humans have canine teeth as well, the two big teeth right here. Okay, so meat-eating animals like dogs, tigers, bears, they all have these teeth and they all eat meat. So this guy says that humans are meant to eat meat because we have canine teeth. Okay, again, there are lots of people who believe that people should eat meat. Look at this guy. This guy says humans are not meant to eat cooked food. When you cook the food, it kills all the healthy substances in the food. You should eat raw food, raw fruits, raw vegetables. Okay, so there's a lot of people in the world who believe in that school of thought. If you don't believe me, just go on YouTube and search for raw vegan diet. You're going to see hundreds and thousands of people who say that being a raw foodist, they're called raw foodists, that's the most healthy thing a person can do. If you cook the food that's bad, you're going to get sick and all of that stuff, okay? So let's take a look at this school of thought. These people believe God made the universe, okay? Now, even though this is just one idea or one opinion, there's going to be other opinions attached to it, right? It's going to be a larger thing. For example, the meaning of life. This is going to affect what a person believes about the meaning of life, the purpose of life, the origin of life, the destiny of human existence. Okay, where is this? Where are we going as humans? Okay, so look at this woman and her friends. They say there is no God. Evolution caused everything. Life ultimately has no purpose. Okay, so that's the opposite school of thought. These people believe there is a God. These people believe there isn't a God. There are two different schools of thought. Okay, now look at these two people. They both believe that there is a God and God made everything. That guy believes God is good. This woman believes God is evil. Okay, those are different schools of thought, right? Or look at these two people. They both believe that God is good. That guy believes there's one God, and this woman believes there are many gods. Again, those are two different schools of thought. So, you can see that when we use this term school of thought, we're talking about a set of ideas that contrast with another set of ideas. Okay, so that's really what the term school of thought means. It means a set of ideas that's somehow unique, somehow different from another set of ideas. Okay, just like this, capitalism and socialism. Capitalists believe the government should be limited. Okay, low taxes, everyone should be free to do what they want to do. Socialism, on the other hand, says that the best form of government is where the government is bigger and it does more things. For example, it offers free healthcare, free education, different government programs, and also higher taxes to pay for those programs, right? So both of those are very different schools of thought. Okay, now we often use the word subscribe when we talk about a school of thought. But you could say, I don't subscribe to that school of thought. Just like you subscribe to a YouTube channel, right? If you like that channel, you're going to subscribe to it. Just like I hope you subscribe to my YouTube channel. Okay, but if you don't like it, you're not going to subscribe to it, right? For example, let's say I'm a socialist. I say the best form of government a country can have is a socialist government. And you could say, no, I don't subscribe to that school of thought. Okay, look at the Soviet Union. Socialism failed there. Socialism failed in Cuba. Socialism is failing in Venezuela. Okay, so I don't subscribe to that school of thought. Okay, there's different schools of thought. Okay, so why is this important? Well, it's important for making inferences and predictions. Okay, what does this word mean here? Inference. What is an inference? Well, there are two words that people get mixed up quite often. infer and imply. Now, both of these words mean the same thing. They're just on opposite sides, okay, but they mean the same thing. If you're the listener, then you infer something that someone is saying. Okay, if you are the speaker, then you imply. It sort of means you hint at something. Okay, let's take a look at this example. I inferred that he doesn't eat pork because he said he's a Muslim. I inferred that he doesn't eat pork because he said he's a Muslim. Now, did he say he doesn't eat pork? No, he didn't say that. But we inferred it because we know that Muslims generally don't eat pork, right? So we inferred it. Or we could say this, he implied that he doesn't eat pork. Okay, he implied it, I inferred it. Do you see the difference? If it's the person who's speaking or doing something, then he's implying, and if I'm the receiver, then I infer it. Okay, just the same thing, just a little difference there. Okay, let's take a look at another inference. Russia is providing weapons to rebels in eastern Ukraine. Okay, the USA makes this inference. Okay, the USA thinks that Russia is providing weapons to rebels in eastern Ukraine. Now, why do they make this inference? What is their reasoning? Well, here is their reasoning. Now, did Russia say, we are providing weapons to rebels in eastern Ukraine? No, of course not. Russia didn't say that. So the USA is inferring it. Okay, they're guessing it, right? And this is their reasoning. Rebels are getting heavy weapons from somewhere. Someone is giving them heavy weapons. We're not giving them heavy weapons. We, the US, we're not giving them heavy weapons. It must be the Russians. Okay, so this is their conclusion. The rebels are getting heavy weapons. It's not us, so it must be the Russians. Because who else would give them heavy weapons? Okay, that's an example of making an inference. Okay, so inference is very important. And it's important because it helps us to figure out the meaning of things and make predictions, make guesses. You know, it's very important on the CELPIP exam, especially in the listening part 5 and 6, also on the reading part 4, and basically on the whole exam. Okay, this is a very important topic, and not just on the CELPIP exam. This is important for life, for general English knowledge and understanding. Okay, let's take a look at this example here. Every day, John leaves his muddy boots on the porch steps when he gets home. Every day, John leaves his muddy boots on the porch steps when he gets home. What is John's occupation? A banker or a farmer? Okay, what's a porch? Do you know what a porch is? A porch is this front area of the house, just this open area, right? And these are the porch steps. So when John gets home, he leaves his muddy boots on the porch steps, okay? Now, what is his occupation? Do you think he's a banker or a farmer? What do you think? Well, it doesn't say. It doesn't say if he's a banker or a farmer, okay? But we can infer that he's a farmer because of his muddy boots. A banker works inside a bank. So why would a banker have muddy shoes? So we can make this inference that it's a farmer. Okay, let's take a look at this example. Every night, she would kiss him on the cheek before turning out the light and leaving his room. What is the relationship between the two people here? Is it a husband and a wife or a mother and a son? Well, it doesn't say, okay? So we have to make an inference. So the correct answer is mother-son. That's the relationship because, well, there's two hints here in this sentence. The first one is kiss him on the cheek. If it was a wife, she would probably kiss her husband on the lips, right? The second hint is leaving his room. So he has his own room. Okay, now in our culture, I don't know about your culture, but in our culture, husbands and wives usually share the same room. Okay, it'd be much more common for a son to have his own room. Okay, so we know in this sentence that it's a mother-son relationship. I mean, it could also be a different kind of a relationship as well, maybe a grandmother-grandson or something. But if we're given these two options, then it's very clear that this is the one we should pick. Okay, let's take a look at this example. Jenny was gazing at the shiny red box under the tree. Suddenly, her thoughts were interrupted with, "Come eat your breakfast, Jenny." "I don't want to eat breakfast today. I'm too excited," she called back. Okay, so in this short passage, we can make some inferences. Is it summer or winter? Which season do you think it is? We have no idea, right? It didn't talk about any seasons. But the shiny red box under the tree, that can only mean one thing. The tree is inside and there's a shiny red box. What does that mean? That means it's a Christmas tree, and that means the box is a present. So is Christmas in the summer or winter? Well, in most countries like Canada, Christmas is in the winter time. Okay, so we choose winter. So who called for breakfast? Who do you think called Jenny to come eat breakfast? Well, it was probably her mom, right? We can make that inference. Now, why is she excited? Do you know? She's excited because she's looking at her Christmas present. She just wants to open her present. She's so excited, she doesn't want to eat. She's not hungry. She's not thinking about her hunger. She just wants to open her present. Okay, now how old is she? How old do you think she is? Well, it doesn't tell us, but there's a hint. Okay, look at this. "I don't want to eat breakfast today." What is breakfast? Well, lots of children have a hard time making the R sound. R, they can't pronounce R. So they say W instead. Breakfast. So usually if a kid is under 5 years old, they might say it that way. Okay, so is Jenny over five or under five? Well, if we have to make a guess, we would guess she's a young child. I don't know, maybe four or five years old, okay? Because she says breakfast. Okay, that's our hint in the passage. So when you're reading things, or when you're listening to information or something on the CELPIP exam or any other exam or just in life, you have to make these inferences, these tiny little hints and clues as to what might be going on. Okay, very important. So I'm going to read you an article right now called Gun Politics, and I want you to listen for different schools of thought. And we're going, and then I'm going to ask you some questions, and we're going to make some inferences. I want you to listen to the schools of thought. Okay, so the article is on my phone here. Okay, are you ready to listen? Listen carefully. All right. Gun politics is an area of American politics that is defined primarily by the actions of two groups: firearms regulation and gun rights activists. These groups often disagree on the interpretation of laws and court cases related to firearms, as well as about the effects of firearms regulation on crime and public safety. It has been estimated that U.S. civilians own 270 million to 310 million firearms, and that is 35 to 42% of the households in the country have at least one gun. Since the 1990s, debates regarding firearm availability and gun violence in the United States have been characterized by concerns about the right to bear arms, such as found in the Second Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, and the responsibility of the government to serve the needs of its citizens and prevent crime and deaths. Firearms regulation supporters say that indiscriminate or unrestricted gun rights inhibit government from fulfilling that responsibility and causes a safety concern. Gun rights supporters promote firearms for self-defense, hunting, sporting activities, and security against tyranny. Firearms regulation advocates state that restricting and tracking gun access would result in safer communities, while gun rights advocates state that increased firearm ownership by law-abiding citizens reduces crime and assert that criminals have always had easy access to firearms. Okay, so did you get anything in that passage? What are the two schools of thought in the article? Well, one group believes that if everyone has guns, the country is going to be safer. Okay, if people can get guns easier, the country is going to be safer. The other group thinks that if there are lots of guns, then the country is going to be very unsafe. Okay, so there's these two different schools of thought. Now, to understand this article, there were lots of sort of big words that are very important, like advocate. Do you know what advocate means? An advocate means someone who supports something. Okay, so it used the word advocate on both sides here. There's the gun rights advocates and the gun regulation advocates. Okay, so let's take a look at this question. Firearms regulation advocates would say that a mass shooting could likely have been prevented if the perpetrator had undergone a screening test at the time of purchase, or more people at the scene had possessed guns. Okay, do you understand the question? Which one is right? Firearms regulation advocates would say that a mass shooting could likely have been prevented means stopped, if the perpetrator had undergone a screening test at the time of purchase. Okay, that means the perpetrator means bad guy, the guy who is going to do the crime. Okay, so we have to know this firearms regulation advocate. So which group is this? Are these the people who like guns or who want guns to be regulated? They want guns to be regulated. So what do they think? They think maybe this shooting could have been prevented if the perpetrator had undergone a screening test at the time of purchase. Okay, this one would be right if it had said what? Gun rights activists. Okay, there's the two groups. The gun rights activists would say, yeah, if everybody at the scene, let's say it's a school shooting, if all the teachers and other staff had guns, then it would have prevented, or it might have prevented this. It would be better if everyone had guns. This group thinks, no, it's better if nobody has guns. Okay, now, gun rights activists would likely point to what as a defense for their beliefs. Would they point to the U.S. Constitution, or would they point to international statistics? Well, the article didn't say anything about international statistics. Okay, the article talked about the U.S. Constitution, right? In the U.S. Constitution, it says that basically Americans have the right to own guns to protect themselves from the government, from everyone. Okay, so the answer is the U.S. Constitution. Okay, let's look at this one. Firearm regulation advocates want to ban the sale of firearms. Is that true or false? Do they want to ban the sale of firearms? No. It's False. They don't want to ban. To ban means to make it illegal to buy guns. They don't want to do that. They want to regulate the purchase of guns. They think it's okay for if people want to hunt and do whatever with their guns, that's okay. But we need to regulate it so that not anybody can just walk into a store and buy a gun. We're actually right now, that's basically how it is in the US. Anybody can just go to a store like Walmart and buy a gun. Okay, and they think, no, it needs to be regulated. Okay, so this lesson has gone a little bit too long. What does your country think about guns? What does your country think about? I'm sort of curious to know, because here in Canada, actually guns or gun sale, firearm sales are regulated. You need a license, you need a permit, you need to sort of go through a process before you can get a gun. Okay, but in the US, like I said, anybody can get a gun. Now, it's interesting because here in Canada, we have had very few mass shootings. I mean, in the past 3 years, I don't know, maybe like 10 people have died in mass shootings. But in the US, in the past few years, hundreds of people have died in mass shootings. So it's very interesting. It's sort of crazy. Here in Canada, we have gun regulation. In the US, they don't have gun regulation. But I want to know, in your country, can you just buy a gun? Or do you need to go through some regulations and that process? Let me know in the comments down there. And I'll see you over in the next episode of Mad English TV. Take care.